This is a download from Rutland Radio.
Hello, and thank you for downloading the Rutland Radio podcast from rutlandradio.co.uk. This is where you can hear the best bits from the last week. Can you believe by this Friday we'll actually be into a new month? And here on Rutland Radio, we have a new voice in the afternoon starting today. Welcome, Jennifer Lee. Welcome to the studio.
Hello.
I know you've been in it a few times actually doing Rob Wagstaff's Classic Hits in the afternoon.
I have.
But welcome officially to the team and also to the morning listeners as well. So we're going to do this getting to know you just so that the listeners can kind of get an idea of who they've got on the radio from 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I'll do a few quick fire things to start with.
Okay.
Run or walk?
Run.
Excellent. Me too. Shower or bath?
Oh, I love a bath.
Yeah, absolutely. I do. Never seem to have time. Need to run towards it. TV or film?
Film.
Film. Wow. Yeah, I wish I could stay awake till the end of them. Meat or fish?
Fish.
And cats or dogs?
Oh, I do like a dog in a coat. Dog then.
Oh. Yes, I suppose. See, at this time of year, they would be in a coat. And, you know, from what you've gleaned so far, because I know actually, you know, you're not from all that far away anyway.
No.
But your favourite thing about Stamford and Rutland so far?
Oh, I love the quaintness of the villages. They're just so picturesque.
I'll see you this afternoon from 3 o'clock on Rutland Radio.
The weekly Rutland Radio podcast.
Zoe Croson.
Stephen Arnold.
Phoebe.
And we're talking here at the Santa Fun Run presentation. It seems a world away, actually, when there was a sea of Santas there, but a massive attendance and a really significant amount of money for you, all raised on one day.
Absolutely huge. We're totally thrilled and overwhelmed with the amount raised. £3,500 is a colossal amount to such a small charity like ours, so we're really overwhelmed with that, really. It surpassed, I think, everybody's expectations from a Rotary Club. When we first met up with them, you know, it's a case of we were just thrilled to be chosen as one of the three charities. So very, very happy.
And you've said on social media recently you're at the kind of halfway point as to where you'd like to get at £110,000 in total.
Well, we've actually donated £110,000 to research, which is, again, it's a significant amount when it goes directly to research. There's never a figure that's enough, really, to be honest. It's just we've got to just keep Phoebe under the right radar, obviously help other children with a very awful disease. We're doing lots of other projects in the pipeline as well to create revenue streams. So for us, it's all about the more we can raise, the more awareness we can raise, the better. So there's no overall total, to be honest, Rob.
Phoebe, how are you feeling these days?
Good.
Yeah? How's school been? Have you been able to be there quite a lot and you haven't had to be in hospital too much? How have things been for you? You still have to go to hospital sometimes, don't you? And what's that like?
Not so fun, is it, Phoebe?
No, I understand.
She's kind of a bit shy.
And Stephen, for you now as being, you know, part of the charity and also with your stage work, you've been raising money as well yourself.
Yeah, we did Kez in October last year, 2018. Really, really enjoyed that, you know, and to raise money for such a great cause was fantastic, just doing what I'm doing, basically. And I did Panto at Christmas and Trio Entertainments let us put buckets out. We raised just short of £2,000, so it's going really well. It's a great start to the year, and then of course these guys doing the run, it's fantastic to get what we get, and it's overwhelming, really. And just like to thank everybody for the support, everybody that ran on the day, you know, that took part. It really helps.
Jolie Garner, senior community fundraiser.
Catherine Cole, nurse at Thorpe Hall Hospice.
And we're all familiar in this area of the Sue Ryder name, and we kind of think down in Peterborough, but it's so much actually works with people across Stamford and Rutland, the area that we serve.
Yeah, absolutely. So last year we cared for 38 people and their families living within the Stamford postcode. So, you know, a big number of people. It's not just Peterborough people. We care for lots of people in South Lincolnshire and their loved ones as well through a really difficult time.
And actually working as a nurse, you must actually get so involved with the individual journeys that people have, and it must be different for everyone as well.
Absolutely. It's you build relationships with patients and their families. It's a journey that they're going through. As we always say, we can't change the journey. They can't change the outcome.
It's fine. I knew where you were going with that. So that's okay. We can edit. Yeah.
You can't change the outcome, but you can change the journey. It's a very rewarding job, and it's very humbling to spend time with these people and to be able to do the best that you can for them. And we couldn't do what we do without the fundraising and without everybody's support.
And you do have to raise an awful lot of money each year.
Yes, we have to fundraise £2.4 million every year, and it is with thanks to groups like the Rotary Club of Stamford Burley putting on the Santa Fun Run that helps make that possible. It was an absolute fantastic day. A team from Thorpe Hall took part and thoroughly enjoyed it, and every penny that's been raised from that event and donated to the hospice is going to make a real difference to patients and their loved ones.
John Sutcliffe, President of Stamford Burley Rotary Club.
And we're here having seen the cheques presented tonight from the Stamford Santa Fun Run. It was an incredible day, wasn't it, in terms of people to start with?
Yeah, we had record numbers of entries. Normally we have about 800 entries. This year we had over 1,300. And probably with supporters and other members of the families, we were about 1,800 people all up on the park at Burley. In a most beautiful day, a magic day, lots of sunshine and lots of happy smiling faces and Santas running around.
And it's also meant that you've been able to actually gift a larger amount than you were expecting for the charities that you support.
Yes, we made just over £14,000 in total from the event, and that's about 3.5 times as much as we normally make. And therefore, for the charities that we endorsed for this event, we were able to give them each £3,500 and also retain some for our own uses with local charities.
And that must feel like a great position to be in, that people in this area have helped you achieve that.
It's all down to people in this area. We try to keep the charity basis, even if they're national charity. We focus on the local branch, as it were, and it's very much a local event. And although we get runners from Peterborough, which is great, we even get some as far as Cambridge, we get Oakham. And although it's great to have that support, at the end of the day, the focus is on it's a Stamford event in Stamford's most famous landmark. And everyone has a great day, community day out, as well as it doing good works for the charities.
You obviously had a lot of new faces this year. It's hard for them just to do the run once, don't you think?
We'd love to think that, Rob, because the more they come back, the better. Interestingly enough, though, about 2/3 of our runners every year didn't do it the year before. They're new entrants. That's inevitable in an event like this because families will do it and families grow up. What we are now seeing, though, is families coming back. And we've got the first wave of parents now bringing their young children back because it's been going 12 years. And that's great to see that happen.
Rutland Radio.
It's Zoe Doherty, and I'm the fundraiser for CPSL Mind, which stands for Cambridgeshire, Peterborough and South Lincolnshire.
And Mind, obviously, mental health. And we're talking about Mind, the actual charity itself.
Well, we're affiliated to National Mind, but there are around 130 local minds across the country, and it's the local minds that provide the direct services to people who are recovering from mental health challenges.
So do you actually work with them on a local level, effectively, those
yes.
individuals?
Yep, we work with people on a one-to-one basis. We do workshops, peer support groups, and we also work with people who are very poorly within their homes, sort of helping them with their recovery.
And what does something like this mean to you? I mean, any money is welcome, but actually, you know, there's almost a three-way split with mental health being a focus on it this year.
It's wonderful that local people are supporting mental health and our charity. It's been great working with Stamford Rotary because it's not just about raising the money, which is fantastic, and that goes towards direct services in the local area. But it's also about raising awareness that we exist, getting everybody to talk about mental health. So we were able to have a stand at the event. We had some of our own staff running and raising money that way. And also being able to talk to local people just about the services that we offer. It's as important for us that we raise awareness of the issues as it is about the fundraising. So this partnership has been fantastic for us.
So how does it? How do people tend to actually find you? Do they find you through NHS referral? Do they find you, you know, in the phone book or online? What's the typical route for people?
Lots of different ways. It's NHS referral. It's through GPs. People can self-refer via our website. National Mind obviously refer to local minds as well. So it's a bit of everything, really.
And how do you specifically help people? Do you support them through counselling and therapies in that way?
It's mainly through sort of one-to-one work counselling and support, but we also do peer support workshops. We do a lot of training as well, so we'll work with voluntary groups and also corporates as well, training them in mental health first aid, ASSIST, which is suicide prevention. We also work with local organisations to talk about mental health in the workplace, so we do a lot of training. We also do a lot of campaign work as well, so we have our Stop Suicide Prevention campaign, which we run across the country, and that's encouraging people to sort of raise awareness of the warning signs of suicide. And we also work with schools as well. We have a Stressless campaign, so it's all about educating young people about mental health, and they have to come up with 5 different ways to improve their well-being over 5 weeks. So it's mainly one-to-one support, but mental health sort of affects lots of different people in lots of different ways. So as an organisation, it's about raising awareness, and it's also about coming up with lots of different channels and different ways in which we can support people in their mental health recovery.
Highlights from the past 7 days, the Rutland Radio Podcast.
Helen Howe, Chair of Mindspace Stamford.
And we know, I suppose, what seemed in a way Dr. Dan's vision for supporting the town as this worked through a GP and mental health specialist. But there must be so many people involved with Mindspace now and all the work you're doing at the Shack particularly.
Yeah. Well, we have a range of work now. So we have one strand of work that's looking around children and young people. So we are running a pilot scheme with the Blue Coat School in Stamford, and they are looking at promoting positive mental health and well-being with all of their young people. And then we're going to look at some impact evidence and then share that with all Stamford head teachers and also then to Lincolnshire. Today I've been in a meeting with the principal of Stamford Welland Academy and one of the senior leaders at New College. So we're then going to see how we can look at that cross phase. So we're working with young people, but we've moved from our weekly cafe and weekly walks to getting on the sort of just on the cusp of being able to develop a week round offer. So that will include some physical activities, which is known for supporting mental health. So we have boxing for wellness, we have yoga, we have some art therapy, and we're then hoping to extend some of our cafe provision from once a week to having some cafes open sort of during the course of the day, and develop our walks from just the weekly walk around Burley to being able to go further afield. And one of our sort of big projects is to develop a listening service. So we're currently developing a programme with an expert in terms of developing listening skills. And we had a recent recruitment drive. So we have some volunteers who have been identified as to go into our sort of first wave around induction and then to be trained as listeners. And we hope then over time to go from what might be a listening light service to something that will be more bespoke around individuals. So from very small beginnings, there's a big vision around Stamford being the most flourishing town, but there's a lot of work and different strands of work that are currently being developed. And we're trying to also have a piece of clinical work that says, how can we work around prevention to make Stamford a suicide-free town? But we are at a... not sure I want this bit on there, but we're in a particularly exciting time because we've just heard last week that we have registered charity status. So that's also going to allow us to work closely with other organisations as well. So it's an exciting time for Mindspace Stamford.
And about how many people would you say you've helped over the time you've been around and continue to help?
Well, if we looked at the numbers who attend our events, and if we were to sort of count them in terms of number of attendees, you know, we have well into the 800 and 900 attendances at some of our events. Now, obviously, some of that will be repeat attendees, but at the moment, I mean, we've gone from what was maybe a regular group of 10 or 15 to, if we were to look at all of those who attend the boxing, the yoga, the art therapy, we're definitely close to sort of getting near 100 sort of regular attendances. But our biggest scope will be when we work with, if say we're working with schools, because we're then working with staff, they're working with the young people, and that will allow us to really extend our reach.
And just finally, the bit you said you didn't particularly want included.
Well, it was only the bit about, because registered charity status, yeah. So we've sent a press release today to the Mercury.
Right.
Okay. So but it might be nice to do, well, hopefully, yeah. But yeah, it might be nice to do a piece just on that, really, and get another interview with Dan.
So, I mean, what does registered charity status mean to you as an organisation? Does it kind of give you more power to be recognised and be able to ask for things?
It validates us, and it gives organisations a confidence that we are a bona fide organisation whose aims have been scrutinised by the Charity Commission. And they, in recent years, following the Kidscape issues, have become more and more stringent in terms of the standards they expect you to be able to meet. So it means that if people are looking to sponsor us or to have us as their charity of the year, if it's a business, they won't do that unless you are a registered charity. So it's a massive step for us.
Rutland Radio.
And welcome back to the Breakfast Show. Jennifer Lee, how was yesterday for you? I enjoyed it.
It was fabulous.
It's a long old time, is it? 4 hours in this little box here.
It is. It's nerve-wracking.
Let's continue with...
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you.
Especially like that at the end. It's almost like you should do a sort of ballet. You know what I mean? A little twirl in the studio. We have five more quick fire questions for you then. Facebook or Twitter?
Facebook.
Phone call or text?
Phone call.
Oh, that's good. Well, you're in the right business, aren't you? Because if you sent texts between songs, no one would be able to understand. Sunrise or sunset?
Ooh, sunset.
Yeah, I know what you mean. It's a tough one though, isn't it?
Yeah, that's a tough one.
Starter or dessert?
Ooh. What about if they order starter and I order dessert, then we still get three, but a little taste of each.
Oh, that's good. Yes, I see what you mean. You're getting value for money. You're
more, but not the calories.
I know, exactly. And Star Trek or Star Wars?
Neither. I hate them.
I like a bit of honesty. More this afternoon from 3 on Rutland Radio.
Rutland Radio's best bits on the podcast.
It's Rutland Radio breakfast time. I'm Rob Pisani. I was off for a few days not so long ago. I only went just an hour down the A1, actually. However, Tim McCrill, who's sitting opposite me, went all the way to where the Osprey from Rutland are in the winter. Notably the Gambia area. Tim, thanks for coming in. Whenabouts did you get back?
We got back about a week ago, Rob, so come back to freezing January temperatures, which is it's a bit of acclimatisation required.
Now, the whole project, the Osprey Leadership Foundation, just give us a brief summary of what that is for anyone who hasn't caught it just yet.
Well, basically, it's a charity that I set up last year, and it's basically, Ospreys are integral to the story because basically we're working with young people in different countries on the Ospreys flyway from Rutland to the Gambia to help them to become the conservation leaders of the future. So I was very lucky in the early part of my career, or before I even embarked on my career, to have some fantastic opportunities at Rutland Water. And so what we want to do is to encourage other young people with an interest in nature to help them to develop that interest and hopefully begin a career in conservation and then, you know, really start to make change in the world, which, as we all know, is desperately needed.
So they're doing that in their local communities, effectively.
Yeah, so what we say about the foundation is effectively it's kind of grassroots in its approach, but it's international in the scope, because we're talking about, you know, the whole of the Ospreys flyway, and we're starting off with projects locally in Rutland and the UK, but also at the other end of the flyway down in West Africa, in the Gambia specifically. So we're working with some of the communities there to encourage young people to get out and enjoy nature. And I know from taking groups down to West Africa that it's an incredibly biodiverse and rich area. But it's also a very poor area. It's an incredibly underdeveloped part of the world. And many of the school children, you know, attend school with schools with tin roofs and generator power and very few resources. So very few opportunities to learn about things like nature. So hopefully, in our own small way, we're making a contribution and making a difference.
So how are you managing to do that? Was this a sort of fact-finding mission, going out and seeing, you know, what was on the ground?
Well, I first took a group out to West Africa in 2011 when I was running the Osprey project. And we met a guy there, Junkung Jadama, who's a bird guide, a Gambian bird guide. And I've basically become really close friends with him. And he's coordinating the foundation's work out in the Gambia. So he actually goes into schools and basically provides, you know, talks on ospreys, but not just ospreys. Ospreys are kind of the focal point. It's more talking about nature generally and conservation. And then the most important part of the work he does is he takes those young people out into the countryside, into the area surrounding where they live, just to teach them about the amazing birds they have. And of course, ospreys and many migratory birds from Europe spend the winter there. So from a conservation point of view, it's essential that those communities learn about what they have around them. But also it's giving those young people who live in very poor areas an opportunity that simply isn't there otherwise.
So our ospreys from Rutland, they're obviously down that way at the moment. I know you saw one or two. Did you actually see Rutland ospreys in Gambia?
We did, yeah. Well, actually, we saw a Rutland osprey just over the border in Senegal, but it's as good as. It's a few kilometres north. It was at a place called the Sinsaloum Delta, which is a huge area of mangrove and shallow water in Senegal, just north of Gambia, as I said. And this particular osprey, we actually saw 3 years ago. And so we knew roughly where it would be because they're very faithful to the same wintering site. So we went along in a boat with a group, and many of the people with us were volunteers from the project. So they're really excited. And we got to the spot, saw an osprey, and managed to get the colour ring on the bird's leg so we could positively identify it. And it's a bird that actually fledged from the Manton Bay nest in 2011. So he comes backwards and forwards to Rutland every spring, and that is his winter home. So that specific part of the Sinsaloum Delta is where he is every winter. And for me, it was just a reminder of the incredible journeys they make, but also how Rutland is linked to that part of the world, because the ospreys are becoming more and more synonymous with the county. And yet, in a way, they spend just as much time in West Africa as they do here. So I think it's a really nice link. And that's something that I'd like to kind of develop and hope we can foster, you know, greater links between Rutland and that part of West Africa, because we have got this amazing bird in common.
That is unbelievable to think about, isn't it? That they always go to the same place in the winter, always come back to Rutland in the summer. They have a 2 week journey either way, and the rest of the time they're there in familiar surroundings.
Yeah, and it really is familiar because they do literally go and sit on the same tree every year. And then, of course, when they come back to Rutland, they nest on the same nest every year. So they're creatures of habit.
So the Osprey Leadership Foundation, how is that going and what are the next plans for it?
Well, it's still early days, but I'm pleased to say that, you know, we're progressing well. One of the key initiatives we've set up in the Gambia is something called Osprey Clubs, which actually we set up a few years ago through the Rutland Osprey Project. And so it's a partnership with the project. And that essentially is what I talked about earlier, where JJ goes into the schools and takes the kids out on field trips. But what we want to develop through the foundation is some more initiatives to help those young people who join the Osprey Clubs but then finish school and then don't have any opportunities. So we're actually going to fund our first student through university next year, a guy called Dembo Jatta, who was one of the first Osprey Club members. He wants to do a degree in conservation biology, and there's just no way he could afford to do it without help. We met another young woman actually, who's now 22, but she was a member of the club at Carton School for 3 years. She wants to become a professional bird guide. So you can really see how the project and the foundation is starting to have an impact with those young people. And, you know, from my point of view, it's really exciting because I kind of think, well, they're the opportunities I had. And if we're in somehow able to replicate those kind of opportunities for young people with amazing potential, but with no other opportunities, then that's something that's really exciting. So we're developing a couple of schemes, one called Future Conservation Leaders and another called Stars of the Future, which is really to help those young people who we really see as having a future in conservation. And one of the key elements will be to get young people in the UK and in the Gambia together and working together to kind of foster relations. Because if you're talking about the conservation of birds like the osprey that have this incredible migratory range, you have to get people working together. And that's a real kind of ethos of the foundation.
So effectively, the fundraising that you're doing here is helping the standard of conservation education in West Africa.
That's the idea. And we're just setting up a new scheme called Friends of the Foundation. So that's on the Osprey Leadership Foundation website, which is ospreylf.org. And it'd be amazing if local people might think about supporting that. Because as I say, Rutland has this incredible link to West Africa, you know, through the migration of the osprey. And I really passionately believe that we have an amazing opportunity to help people down there, and helping people down there benefits birds like ospreys, benefits many other migratory species. So it's all about kind of working together for those purposes.
So you can find out more information online. And what would be your single biggest memory of this trip?
Well, there's two memories, good and bad. So I'll start off with the bad one because I want to finish on an upbeat note. But the bad one was the plastic pollution on Tangi Beach, which is a beach that we've visited for many years, but I've never seen it as bad. And it kind of really hit home to me the impact that we as humans have on the planet, whether we're in Rutland, whether in the Gambia. A lot of that plastic pollution will have just been washed up from the sea. We know that a truckload of plastic is basically dumped in the sea every minute of every day, which, you know, really, just think about that. It's a huge amount and a massive, massive impact. But also, countries like the Gambia just don't have the refuge systems to dispose of, well, not just dispose, but to recycle plastic waste. There are some initiatives that are just starting in the Gambia to make use of some of that plastic waste. But basically, there's just not the capacity to deal with it. You know, you forget how lucky we are to have a recycling bin outside our homes in Rutland and Stamford. So I think that was just very eye-opening, and it just made me think, you know, we really need to think, all of us collectively need to think about how we can change our habits to reduce the plastic we're using, because it doesn't just impact our local area, it impacts worldwide. So that was eye-opening. But I think the other really positive thing was seeing that Rutland osprey in West Africa, because to me it just showed me, as I said, how we're linked with that part of the world. And then when I kind of see some of the young people who the foundation's starting to help, I really think that although the world has all these, you know, immense challenges, there are people out there who really want to make a difference. And if we can just help them, give them the opportunity to do that, then they will go on to do great things.
It's amazing work, isn't it, between Rutland and West Africa. And before this morning, if you didn't know about the Osprey Leadership Foundation, you might not have even known that that exists. But Tim McCrill, good to have you back here at Rutland Radio, and thanks for joining us.
Rutland Radio.
I feel like I should say something like, day three in the Rutland Radio studio. And the celebrities are getting bored. But no, we're not actually.
And the celebrities are fighting.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and there's that funny one that you've never heard of. It's a shame they've stopped doing Big Brother, do you think? Were you ever a fan?
No. I hated Big Brother. I don't like anything that makes a celebrity out of someone with no talent whatsoever. Is that too strong an opinion?
Possibly.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you.
The thing is, we are getting to know you just by those kind of things, aren't we, really? And more this afternoon from three. But let's just do some quick fire questions just to finish then.
Can I just reiterate? I'm a yes. Very nice, warm, loving
yeah, of course
person.
You are. Just have some. Yeah. Sometimes you kind of think, why are they famous?
Exactly. And they do things like, to, you know, hurtful things to get in the paper. And I don't like that.
Yes. No, I agree.
Good.
I agree. So we have five different things here then. Just going to fire these at you.
Okay.
Would you rather travel forward in time or back in time?
Back in time.
Like
I'd
a bit
love
of history.
To be a lady, yeah, in a carriage.
We could, when the Georgian Festival is here in September, you'll have to get in one.
Yeah, I'd love that.
They always have that. Restaurant or takeaway?
Oh, that's a tricky one. I do love eating. Can we do one night and the other the next night?
This is like the two different courses thing we did yesterday. Pointless or The Chase?
Oh, I hate them both.
No, I love a bit of Pointless. I love Pointless. I'm a real fan of Pointless. Bottled or tap water?
Oh, tap. All the way.
Snooze or straight out of bed? What about when your alarm goes off?
I do like to adjust a little bit. I have a cup of tea. I sit in bed with a cup of tea for just about half an hour or so.
So do you get out to make the tea or have you got like a tease made?
No, I haven't got a tease made.
I don't know. They're coming back in
apparently. My gran had one of those. Yeah, it actually makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? I like that. I'll get one.
It's just the frothing next to your ear when you're trying to wake up and there it is making the, I'd be scared it was going to scald my head or something.
Yeah, it is a bit dangerous. Maybe you just put a kettle in your bedroom.
We will see you this afternoon from 3 o'clock.
See you then.
Rutland Radio's best bits on the podcast.
Rutland Radio Breakfast Time. I'm Rob Pisani. You know, we're actually illustrated in the centre of the Rutland map that Katie Cardew did last year. While the Stamford map is being updated, not only with new buildings, but Katie would love to know those little bits of Stamford which you think would look great on her map, just to add to things. So, Katie, you've been painting buildings like Harrison and Dunn and Nelson's and stuff?
Yeah, so, the last Stamford map I did was nearly 5 years ago, so we thought it was about time that we did a refresh. It's still one of our best sellers. So Stamford's changed quite a lot in the last 5 years. So it's sort of a case of looking at sort of new shops, and this time I want to include some more sort of quirky features of Stamford. The last map was quite building central, and this time I would love people to sort of come to us with quirky facts and features and maybe some historical characters that can bring the map to life alongside the buildings.
So you're thinking of things like, Daniel Lambert maybe stopping off at an eatery somewhere, or deer at Burley Park or something like that? Or does it stretch out as far as Burley Park or not?
It does. So Burley Park up to North Street, and then on the left, St Peter's Street, and then on the right, across to sort of Priory Road and St Paul Street. So it's quite a big area of Stamford. And yeah, exactly, things like the deer at Burley Park, any sort of specific flora and fauna that's indicative of Stamford, the geese and the swans on the meadows, any sort of things that people go, yep, that's what Stamford is for me. It's the Delaney bus, it's the Daniel Lambert. So yeah, we're looking for some interesting and fun things to put on the map. If you know any really lovely buildings, of course, submit your ideas for those, but as well as the buildings, some features to bring the map alive.
And I know you've got a list as long as your arm of shops and stuff, because businesses in town would love to be illustrated on this, so you're working on that side of it, but as you say, it's the extras.
Yes, it's the extras, yeah. So we've got a lovely list of people, independent businesses have been submitting photos and a little story about why they love retailing in Stamford, which is fantastic, especially with the sort of the hashtag Shop Stamford initiative, which has been sort of quite popular in the last couple of months. So we'd like to sort of bring attention to the independents. But yeah, it's sort of, yeah, the buildings are wonderful, but it's the little features and the animals and the people and the quirky facts about Stamford, which I think will really bring this map and give it a bit of character.
So it's a week on Friday, then you're going to kind of close entries and submissions
yes.
on this.
Yeah.
So people need to really get thinking in the next week or so.
Yes, please. Yeah. And you can email us at info@kcillustrations.co.uk or Facebook us. It's at Katie Cardew Illustrations and same for Instagram. So there's lots of ways to get in touch with us. We want your stories, your ideas, your inputs, and whatever we can put onto the map, we will.
And this will all be ready for the summer?
Yes, hopefully. Fingers crossed. I've got some big projects lined up, so it's got to fit amongst that. But yes, it's started and it's looking lovely. So hopefully by the summer, we will. It will all be finished and ready to go on sale.
We can't wait to see it. It is becoming, when tourists come here or those who live here, they want a piece of Katie Cardew, don't they?
Thank you, Rob. Yes, that would be wonderful. And people asked, the Rutland map went down so well. And as I said, the Stamford map still goes down well, but I am conscious of the fact that it is possibly a little bit outdated. So I think a refresh will work wonders.
Rutland Radio.
So we're here in Bourne for the annual Lempic Trust lecture this year with Gervase Finn, who we have spoken to on Rutland Radio on numerous occasions. Now, we remember that school inspector was your vocation, and then you've ended up kind of taking that on by reflecting on life and writing more since, I suppose.
Yes. I don't know if there was a vocation, actually, Rob, to be a school inspector. But I was very, very lucky. I'm blessed in life because I'd written a book about the stories and there were anecdotes about the children and teachers that I'd met touring, particularly around the Yorkshire Dales. And it's, I suppose my books are more, they've been described as a kind of the James Herriot of schools sort of books. They're anecdotal and observational and funny, and sometimes quite poignant. So I was very blessed because I didn't expect them to do particularly well, but then when they became bestsellers, I had that wonderful opportunity of going into the chief inspector and saying, well, I'm going to finish. How are you going to survive with four children and a mortgage? I said, well, I've got a cheque. And I showed him the cheque and the rest is history, really. And then since then, that was when I was 20 years ago, I've just written poetry and stories and anecdotes and still speaking and conferences and things.
So it's all about life, I suppose, and observations on how people of all ages tackle it.
Yes, I think, you see, children are a very rich source of humour and also heart-rending sometimes. You know, I mean, I was in York once, a little girl came up to me and six and just stared up at me. I was inspecting the school and said, have you ever thought that when I'm 21, you'll probably be dead? And walked away, you know. Or a little girl in the sand tray, she got a sand tray and a water tray, and she was six in an infant classroom, and she was got a bucket, and I said, what's your name then? She said, well, I'm Chelsea. I said, hello, Chelsea, what are you up to then? Well, I'm making a sandcastle, but my sand keeps coming out of my bucket. I said, well, you have to put some water from the water tray with it. Don't want to. I said, but if you put some water, mix it with the sand with your fingers, you make it quite damp, you see, and that don't want to. I said, I'll show you what to do, because I've got eight grandchildren, and I make lovely sandcastles, and got some water from the water tray and made the sandcastle. I said, now you have a go. And she looked at me and she had eyes like arrow slits and said, I don't want to. And I said, well, why don't you want to do it then, Chelsea? And there's a lovely pause and she just said, because Jamie's just weeding the water tray. Now, people said, do I make it up? I couldn't make it up. And the number of times, you know, little children have said, like the little girl who said to me in a corner of a classroom once, she again, a little girl of six, and she said, can you do add-ups? I said, well, yes. She said, can you do takeaways? I said, yes. Can you do gazinters? I said, what? Two gazinter four, four gazinter eight. I said, yes, I said, I'm very good at gazinters. And she said, well, you better move because you should be on the top table. Now, the sort of innocence of it, it's not my humour is, I'm a great listener, I'm a good listener. They're not inventive in the sense that I've not just made them up in that sense, like many comic writers. I observe people, but children are just absolutely delight. Most children, I should say. The little ones, I mean, Coleridge said that there's nothing so affecting as the sweet innocence of young children, as you will find, Rob, with your little girl, little Florence, as she grows up and she comes from a home where she's loved and cared for and read with and talked to and taken places. And children, little ones are very vulnerable and very open. And what I found fascinating is about the youngsters, little ones, because they don't know about skin colour, race, background, religion. They don't know about status and money or Brexit or Donald Trump. You just smile, as you'll know with your child, you smile at that little face and the smile is invariably returned. And that's why they're very special, very precious children. Sometimes I've left a school sometimes when I've been moved to tears by children. I'm patron of a charity that about children to be adopted. And I still remember the little girl in the wheelchair and smiling little face. And I read some stories with them, and I was going out, and she just wheeled a chair up to me and said, "Mr. Finn, would you adopt me?" And I said, "I can't." I said, I'm too old." And I admire so much people who foster children and adopt children and give them another chance in life to be able to achieve something. And I think in schools, the big things that I always felt led to any achievement with children was self-esteem, feeling good about yourself, and expectation. If you've got adults, as you will with your little girl, you know, you don't pressure her, you don't push her, but you encourage her and you expect that she will, you know, do well. Here I'm rambling on, Robbie, aren't I?
I know.
Chattering on.
Well, you'll be doing a lot more of that tonight here
at
the Corn Exchange. How do you recall it all? I mean, you've got this kind of, everything must be on a shelf in a box. In your head, that.
I've got a very, very good memory, but it's not the same as intelligence, I should say. Having a really good memory is not the same as being intelligent. There's a difference. And I wouldn't say that I'm a massively intelligent person. I'm one of the average in terms of that, the big hump in any academic bell. But it helped me through my O-levels to get good O-levels because it was a memory test. Exams are often, particularly history, geography, literature, subjects like that. It's memory. And if you can... whereas chemistry, physics, maths, memory doesn't help you an awful lot. Although you can remember some things from chemistry, but so I do remember that. And I'm still doing quite a lot of charity and work and speaking. And I've been invited down to Bourne tonight for this Lenpic charity, which is an amazing thing. It must have been an amazing man to support and help all these charities around here, you know, for care homes and disabled children and all this. And it's a great, great legacy that he will leave behind, because we all want to leave behind hopefully memories of us. And he's everywhere. You're sitting in this room, what he's achieved and what he's given. So it's a nice audience tonight. I've got about 12 people coming, so it should be all right. Actually, I've got a good audience tonight.
Yeah. And you've played to audiences around this area on a number of occasions, actually. I think you were last raising... it was a fundraiser for the Leprosy Mission over in Peterborough, I think, the last time you were here.
Yes, that was amazing, the Leprosy Mission. There's some really good people in the world and giving up their time to... the Leprosy Mission was interesting because I do a talk every year for a doctor who's... daughter is a doctor who works in India and Pakistan with people who suffer from leprosy. So it was really interesting that. I've still got the tea towel. They gave me a tea towel about the Leprosy Mission. So, yeah, I came down for that. It was good. That was at the theatre, wasn't it? Was that in Rutland or...?
Peterborough, I think.
Peterborough. It was in Peterborough. Yeah, yeah.
But lovely to have you back in the area. Thanks for... joining us on Rutland Radio, and it'll give it all away, but fascinating to talk to you as always. So you were talking about your latest book just before we finished.
Yeah, I'm still writing. I was saying to the library, I went into the library here in Bourne and said I'd like some books by the best-selling author, Gervase Finn. And she said, oh, looked at me. The last time I went into Waterstones, I said, "Are there any books by Gervase Finn?" And the assistant said, "I think you'll find that the name is pronounced Gervais Finn, and you'll find her books in romance." So, it's great to be down here. I'm not doing the theatre tours at the moment because I'm getting on, but I'm still doing quite a lot of it. So, and people here, I've got to say, have been as hospitable and friendly and good-hearted as any Yorkshire people. So it's lovely to be here, you know.
Thanks so much for joining us on Rutland Radio once again.
Thank you for coming.
The weekly Rutland Radio podcast.
Well, here at Rutland Sailing Club at Gibbet Lane, Edith Weston, there's something of a very chilly breeze here today. I know the wind's not quite so bad tomorrow. I'm here with Ian Walker, who, well, I suppose is synonymous, really, not only with sailing, but with the John Merrick's weekend as well. People are kind of looking at me, shaking their heads, thinking, what are we doing here?
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it? I mean, it's a bit of a pilgrimage, really, an testament to many people's sort of memories of John, why we're here. This is the kind of weekend he probably would have been out training as a young lad, and what made him one of the best sailors Britain's ever produced. So I think it's not just about the sailors meeting up and a few tales, and hopefully it'll warm up, because right now it's as cold as anything I can remember in the Southern Ocean.
And about 150 entrants. Describe to those who don't kind of understand the sailing world, you know, the locals, what exactly is happening and when this weekend.
It's just a one-off event. We do four races, three today, one tomorrow. People will come from all over Great Britain for this. Boats of all shapes and sizes. They all have a handicap so that you have a time correction. So whatever time you take, it gets adjusted to take into account how big your boat is. And at the end of all that, we have some winners and some fantastic prizes. There'll be a lot of youngsters here. I mean, there's 21 420s, which is the class Johnny used to sail. It's the 25th anniversary today of the first ever Tiger Trophy. And obviously, Everard's support of this event and support of Johnny in his early days when they funded his first boat, you know, it really makes a difference. So I'm nervous about going out sailing in this weather, I have to say, but very excited for the weekend.
Great, thanks very much for joining us on Rutland Radio. And just a summary of John for those who maybe didn't know him, but I know he was local and a lot of people in the sailing world did.
Yeah, so Johnny grew up in Scraptoff, Leicestershire, learned to sail at school and became a member at Rutland Sailing Club, and one day won a prize at the club, which was a brand new boat to use and train in. He went from there all the way up to competing in the Olympics, where I was lucky enough to sail with him, and he won a silver medal in 96, and then very tragically was killed in a car crash aged 26 in 1997. So that's what it's all about, and we're raising money, and all of that money goes back into supporting young sailors and giving those kids who maybe haven't got any money of their own a chance to experience this wonderful sport. So it's the John Merrick Sailing Trust. That's the name of the charity. I'm a trustee. It's 21 years since we set it up, and we've raised nearly £1 million in that time.
And people can come down this weekend and actually watch the action and be part of it as well.
You can come down, and my only advice would be make sure you wrap up warm, because it's Baltic out here.
Well, that's it for this week's Rutland Radio podcast. If you have any comments, you can email us via the website rutlandradio.co.uk, and we'll have a new version on our website from Monday.
This is a download from Rutland Radio. For more information, go to rutlandradio.co.uk. This is a download from Rutland Radio.
Hello, and thank you for downloading the Rutland Radio podcast from rutlandradio.co.uk. This is where you can hear the best bits from the last week.
Hi, Rutland Radio. It's Emma from Shipwrecked. I hope you're all well and enjoying this awful weather at the moment. I can tell you where I'd much rather be, and that is on Shark Island. Shipwreck's on at the moment. It's on E4 at 9 p.m. I watched it when I was younger, and I was obsessed with it, so I thought, definitely going to apply. I never thought I'd get it. Like, thousands of people applied, but I did. And I was so apprehensive after a 24-hour flight and finally getting to the island. I was so nervous to meet everyone, but everyone was just so nice. And I think because we were all in the same position, everyone was quite nervous. But my whole experience was just incredible. Like, even just to be able to have lived on a desert island for 2 months is just surreal and something that I will never forget. It was actually so good that when I got home, I was almost homesick. It was really strange. We'd be on our group chat just wishing we were back there. There's nothing like the view of the sky you get on a desert island. We could literally see the Milky Way. I would describe my overall experience as intense and emotional. Obviously, there is a lot of drama. There is a lot more drama to come. Trust me, this isn't even the start of it. But, you know, in that environment, tensions are just so much more exacerbated. And I think everyone, I mean, I definitely was a lot more sensitive than I usually would be. But it was so much fun. Obviously, it's very edited, so you don't necessarily get to see all of the amazing conversations that we had. And especially on Sharks, all of the building that we did, we built so much. So, you know, if you see anything, any structure that isn't the shelter or the kitchen, then that was all us. But yeah, Shipwrecked was the best experience of my life. I absolutely loved it. It definitely made me a lot
more of a strong person, I would say. So if you've missed it, then catch up. And if you're following it, then stick with it, because the drama is only going to get more intense. Honestly, I've been on the edge of my seat watching it, and I even know what's going to come. So thank you for all the support so far. I've honestly loved reading your messages, and I'm trying my best to reply to everything. So if you want to hit me up on Twitter, I'm Emma Shipwrecked, or Instagram, I'm Emma J Fleming _. Thank you so much for having me to speak on the show, and I hope you all tune in to Shipwrecked.
Highlights from the past 7 days, the Rutland Radio Podcast.
Hannah Seymour.
I'm Amelia Seymour.
And what's your involvement with the project?
So I helped organise tonight's event, and I've been part of the panel, the Young People panel for Resilient Rutland.
And how do you think the night went?
Really well, yeah. So I've chaired the youth panel for Resilient Rutland, and Hannah and myself did a lot of work leading up to this project, and we had to spend a lot of time reorganising questions and rewording things, but I think tonight we really pulled it off and it went well.
And were those questions answered tonight?
I believe so. I think they were answered really well. I think it was quite detailed. So I hope that everyone else who was listening feels that it went well as well.
I know one of your questions was, how will the people of Rutland find out about the project?
Yeah,
what are your thoughts on that?
We thought it was actually really robust, that answer. I think it's very easy for projects to be rolled out and the public not know about it. But if it's going to be advertised on school and online, I think it's an online hub portal they're going to put together. I think that is a really good way of going about it, because everyone has internet access.
And in terms of the funding, I mean, the funding was just unbelievable.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, we were really happy when we heard about that we'd received the funding. That we had a big event like Kendry Barracks to celebrate it.
So what's next for the project?
In February, a lot of things are going to be rolled out. The AMFOI is going to start being rolled out, and the academic resilience approach is going to be rolled out.
Yeah, I think for the moment, it's just using the AMFOI and Young Minds to find what the needs are, and then addressing those needs rather than just trying to put something in.
For us, so that will come September in the schools, and for us, we're just waiting to see what will happen with the youth panel and how that will continue.
Rutland Radio.
It's Rutland Radio Breakfast Time. I'm Rob Pisani, and Teddy Wilson is with us now. Teddy, we have spoken to quite a few times over the years. From an early age, always wanted to be a racing driver. He's now doing that. He's at Formula 4 level. But basically, like all motorsport, I suppose, he needs the sponsorship to continue. He joins us this morning. So how was your season last year?
Yeah, I had a really good debut season. It was my rookie year competing in actual sort of racing cars, some go-karts. I finished 7th in the championship out of 51 competitors. I had 8 podiums over the season, with 3 races off the podium which I finished. Unfortunately, I had 5 DNFs, which really hampered my chances of coming in that top 3 sort of position.
What does DNF mean?
Did not finish.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, yes, so absolutely. So how is that world? It's a full-time thing, I guess. Where are you based when you do that?
I was living in America for about 2.5 months, really, at the beginning of the year. I then travelled to the first 2 races with the team. My dad flew over for the first 2. Then I started coming back, so I had to do some school back here. So I sort of got on with that, and then would fly out for each race, for each event. But it's one of those, when you move up from go-karts to single-seater, so Formula 4, it's really not as intense. There's only 6 race weekends a year, whereas with karting, you're looking at 30 to 40, really.
So you have got time to do stuff in between, and you know, maybe, I suppose, ultimately work in between, but then you need a really flexible job to be able to kind of put down, and a high-earning job, I guess. I mean, what sort of money are we talking about to actually compete in this?
I'd probably say the general is probably about $250,000.
So,
and then I'm looking for this year. I've had offers from the top 3 teams in all number 1 roles, and the top team, they just won just over, well, about 6 figures, low end 6 figures.
So you effectively buy your place, no matter what your talent is.
It's all, you have to have some of the funds to compete. That's the end of, really. There's no free drives going around at the level I'm at currently. So you do have to have funds through funding, sponsorship, investors, or family money. So it may be the case.
Because we obviously used to seeing Formula One, and we see, you know, the adverts all over them, these big sponsorship deals, and the drivers are paid huge amounts of money. But I suppose all those drivers broadly came through Formula 4.
Yeah, that's the start of really a racing driver's career is through Formula 4 in the single-seater department. So they all sort of, it was named different things back in the day, but it's the first stepping stone on the way to Formula 1 or IndyCar or wherever they might end up.
So you've clearly got the talent to do it if you finish seventh last year. So what would be your ideal plan? I mean, how old are you now?
I'm currently 17, going on 18 this year. Really the plan is to get myself out there to compete this year with the best team. That will give me the best equipment for the job, and then really it's down to me to perform, and if I do perform and hopefully win the championship, then you get a scholarship prize to do American Formula 3, which is a step above, which basically allows you to race for another season for no expense due to the prize you incur from winning that. So that's really the aim, to get myself, if I can get myself there and perform, then I can get myself another year of racing for nothing, and then opportunities arise from that. So that's really the plan, and the aim is to be an IndyCar in America.
And so is Formula 4 an American tournament, effectively, then? Is it all based over there?
Formula 4 is a sort of worldwide recognised series. Lots of countries have different Formula 4 championships. There's the American Formula 4, British, German, Italian, Japanese. It's really massively covered. And then from there, everyone comes from different parts of the world to compete in certain championships. It's actually quite ironic because in America it's cheaper to compete than if I was to compete in England, although it sounds crazy. The prices in England just astronomical compared to America.
Just how much it costs plus the airfare, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly. Unfortunately, that's the main thing. The travel and all that sort of side of things is expensive in America, but it still doesn't make up the price that it would do to compete in the UK.
So how long have you got before you close the book on next season for actually, you know, getting enough money to do this?
The start of the season, the first race weekend, is the end of April and the last weekend. But probably I need to be secured beginning of April latest, really. So, yeah, not much time, really, on the clock.
Is there anyone else who can help you? Because, you know, I imagine the motor racing world is so well connected.
Yeah, it's hard. We've sort of been pulling all the sort of strings we've got and all the leads we have. But it's extremely hard. Everyone's gunning for the same thing. I mean, we can offer really great things. We have the support race for the Formula One event in Austin. We're also at the NASCAR event. There's lots of hospitality, VIP hospitality we can do. There's 350,000 spectators at the Formula One Grand Prix. So there's a lot that we can offer businesses and also investors, really, if they feel that is what they'd like to do.
So it's all on your website if people can help. And you never know, do you? You have no idea who possibly would, you know, see that as what they wanted to support, and, you know, someone from Rutland like yourself who's got the talent to succeed. And I mean, if you say it quickly, it just needs $250,000 equivalent. So I mean, we're talking almost £250,000 the way the exchange rate is now.
Yeah, well, currently I need about 100, well, I need about 60 grand to get myself out there, being brutally honest. We've got it's 100 grand, really, is what the offer was. So we've got 40 secured. We just need the extra 60 to get myself out there.
Good luck with it all. And hopefully, you know, end of April, you'll be out there and doing it. It must be so hard for you because you've got both of those things to look after. You know, you've got your driving to look after and actually your competition, and then actually raising the money as well must be really tough.
Yeah, raising the money is really pretty much full-time when I'm not in the winter period. I go to the gym every day, and other than that, I'm really just focusing trying to find businesses that might be of interest and people who might take an interest to what I'm doing. Also, I've actually started a GoFundMe page. The link is through my website, so you can click on that and help me in my dream, really. So anything would be really appreciated.
And you need to go to the gym each day to be as fit as, you know, the top racing drivers are. Is that how it is? I mean, people don't think of, you know, it being quite as demanding as that.
Yeah, it is really physically demanding. I feel that if you can sort of, as you're driving, not have to concentrate on if you're like maybe aching or stuff like that, it's got to be an advantage. So I really quite strict with myself to make sure I'm at my top performance, really, at all times.
Teddy Wilson, thanks for joining us on Rutland Radio. I know you're really easy to find on the web, and good luck in continuing this. I really hope you do.
Thank you very much. It's been great being here.
Rutland Radio.
Okay, I'm Matthew Wyatt, and I'm a committee member of the Hallerton Field Working Group.
And you're processing some of the results from today, trying to find out what's beneath the ground in the palace site here in Colley Weston. What sort of things can you find out? And I guess it's a very long process of walking up and down, as we just saw, you know, with your detection equipment.
Yeah, basically this is detection equipment. The one that you've seen working at the moment is called a magnetometer. And it's basically assessing differences in the magnetism of the ground, because all ground naturally has a magnetism, and as soon as you change the ground at all, it gives a different reading, and that's what this machine essentially does. And then you compute it to try and find some nice picture at the end of the day, to find out what's underneath the ground.
Can you tell us anything that you've found so far that might be significant?
At the moment, with this machine, actually, no. We're going to do some more work shortly with a different kind of geophysics process called a resistor. That should probably, if there are buildings underneath the ground, resistivity will find those buildings or the foundations of those buildings. I think the work we've done so far, the ground has been very, very altered to make gardens, and that destroys the footprint of the ground. And I think at the moment the results I'm getting are very mixed. Nothing much is showing up at the moment, but I think I have more confidence in the resistivity than the magnetometry.
And this is to prove whether it's worth actually digging and finding out what's physically there.
Yes, I think it is for the group that are working over here. They now know that, completely unknown to me personally and most of our group, there was a very big palace over here. Yeah, it gives them an idea about where it might have been, what the footprint was, and if they do want to do any actual archaeological work, digging itself, yeah, this is the kind of thing that should point them in the right direction.
So what have you found in Hallerton then?
I suppose the big thing we've found in Hallerton is the treasure site at the top of the hill. And more recently, we've been doing a lot of work on the unknown chapel, medieval chapel, that again is on Harepie Bank, where the bottle kicking takes place. I mean, exactly where the bottle kicking takes place, there is this unknown chapel, medieval chapel. Obviously found all of that up there, which was done with geophysics initially. There's history all around us under the ground, and this is just a great way of finding it without actually having to dig up the ground. And you dig and you destroy, and this doesn't do that. This gives a fingerprint without destroying.
Rutland Radio's best bids on the podcast.
Edward Smith, lead event organiser of the Peterborough Biscuit Business event.
And really, all you need to kind of hear about the event is in the atmosphere, isn't it? Just hits all the huge amount of people here.
Yes, there is. This year, we've sort of gone beyond expectation. We've got over 300 exhibitors, and we've had over 3,000 visitors through our doors today. So we've been very busy today.
And what, in its third year, it's still quite a new event, but it's maybe it's because of the name, maybe it's because of all the different organisations that people know here.
Well, we try and build a business community or a business family. We feel as though Peterborough and the surrounding areas, you know, when you are a business or a small business, any kind of business, you sometimes might think that you are alone. And we like to promote that you aren't. You can come, be a biscuiter, as we like to call you, and become part of our family.
Excellent stuff. So, all in all, what a successful day. I mean, that's broadly the message.
Yes, it is. It's all about how businesses can succeed, even through turbulent times like we're having at the moment, through the country with Brexit. We're still here. We're still having a fabulous day of networking and making sure that, you know, our businesses in the future are future-proof.
And the planning for next year starts almost immediately.
Yes, it actually started last week. So we've already got a sort of a new plan in the making. We've confirmed that we will be back at the Peterborough Arena once again for a fourth year. And yes,
always the first Wednesday in February, I remember.
Yes, it always is the first Wednesday in February, yes. We're having a slightly smaller exhibition next year due to the fact of time constraints, that kind of thing. But it doesn't mean you can't be a part of it. We'll have over 200 stands. So come and be a part of the biscuit.
Rutland Radio.
Here at Oakham Castle on this Wednesday evening with the Lord Lieutenant of Rutland, Dr. Sarah Furness. Now, This was really a focus on your new deputy Lord Lieutenants that you have.
Yes, it was. I was lucky enough to be able to appoint four new deputies, Kathleen Robinson, Air Vice Marshal Nigel Subra, Jeanette Warner and Jamie Weir, all of whom bring special skills to the Lieutenancy team. And I would like to emphasise that although, you know, I'm the Lord Lieutenant and the Queen's representative, I have this wonderful team of deputies. I have up to 15, I think at the moment I have 14, who I can ask to stand in my place if I'm booked for something, or I can ask them to do things for the community. And I want to use that team as a team to do good for the community and to enhance things in the community, and perhaps work with liaison between the military, because we have such a big military presence in Rutland. We're very proud of that military presence, but I would like to see that military presence linking with the wider community and being appreciated by it.
And there are three kind of subcommittees that are working in various areas to reach out to parts of Rutland, really, to be recognised by Her Majesty.
Yes, well, I've set up a business subcommittee which will look at encouraging businesses to apply for the Queen's Awards for Enterprise. There are various categories of that, and we're going to have a presentation day in which we're going to invite businesses to come along to understand how best to make an effective application. Because I think we've got such wonderful businesses in Rutland, and yet we have very few awards winners. I think we only have one. Anglian Water have won in the past. I may be wrong on that, but I don't think I am. But there's certainly very, very few. So I would love to see more. We also have a tremendous amount of voluntary activity. So the Honours Committee will not only be looking at celebrating and instigating applications for individuals to celebrate individual achievement, but we'll also be looking to encourage groups to be applied for to get an honour. And there's the Queen's Award for Voluntary Service, which is the equivalent of the MBE for groups. And I would like to see those being won in Rutland, because, you know we have such fantastic charitable activity, and we ought to be celebrating that, and it ought to be getting national recognition. And that's my aim.
And how are you feeling, actually, many months into the role now? In fact, just over a... We'll be coming up to the year now?
It's a year. Years? No. It's a year in March the 29th.
You've done so much in that year. Yes, that's why
I have. I mean, it's been absolutely wonderful. It's so encouraging seeing how much goes on for the good of all. And I love it. I absolutely relish it. So I'm really enjoying it. Although I must say, just before Christmas, it did become quite hard work, because it was pretty endless. Although all the things I enjoyed, I loved every bit of it, but I was quite tired, so I was quite glad to have quite a quiet Christmas. That was nice. But I love it and appreciate it, and I love being invited to things. And I would say to everyone, please think, and you know, I want to come and I want to meet people and celebrate what's all the good that's going on in Rutland.
And is there any central point where people can find out about you know, the things that we've talked about tonight, the subcommittees, and actually finding out more information? I mean, obviously, we'll be mentioning it on Rutland Radio.
Thank you. The Queen's Awards can be Googled. So, you know, good old Google will come up with all sorts of government or monarchy information. So you can find out how to apply and all the information about it. I have a website, and there are things on that. Yes.
Sarah Furness, thanks very much for joining us on Rutland Radio. And I suppose, you know, the overriding message, as you say, is we have so much in our county, and you would love to kind of get that recognised locally, nationally, and with the help of the monarchy.
Oh, that's right, and celebrate it, yes. And let's all celebrate it and recognise what's going on. And how wonderful that we have been recognised to be the third best place to live in the country. And that's no coincidence. We have so much that's great going on. And I think we really ought to just get national recognition for that too.
The weekly Rutland Radio podcast.
I'm Alan Walters, a county councillor, and I'm the lead member for community safety.
An internet safety event at the showground on Saturday. You've divided it up into different ages, depending on, you know, what people want to find out.
That's right, Rob. What we're looking for is helping parents to find the right way to speak to their children about internet safety. So we've split this down. So in the morning from 11 to 12.30, it's a focus on primary school age children. From 12.30 to 2, secondary school focus. And from 2.30 to 3.30, a little more for the adults about online fraud, spam, security and healthy internet habits.
And I suppose the overall message about the internet is we don't know who we're talking to, and all you can do really is take as many steps as you can to just guard against anyone sort of invading your space, even your bank details, as you say in the last bit.
I think you're right, Rob. The internet is a fantastic thing. I wouldn't want anyone to be afraid to use it. But the best way is perhaps to think of it as a door to the world. And of course, that door also lets the world into your life as well, if you're not careful.
And this is free for people to go along to. Do you want people to let you know that they're interested in coming along?
There's no requirement to pre-book. The more the merrier. Do please come along. Perhaps on this particular event, thinking that you know what to do and believing you're safe is perhaps a little knowledge is a dangerous thing. So even if you think you know about safety on the internet, I would still advise you to come along.
And it's open to anyone around Rutland. I suppose this is, you know, kind of a trailblazing thing as well for the council, working with the police and working with the youth organisations as well, and just trying to get the message across, you know, as responsibility.
It is a responsibility. It's everyone's responsibility. Rutland remains a very safe place to live, but this is certainly one area that's a priority for Rutland County Council and for the community safety team.
And this is only a once a year opportunity. So if you can't make this one, then, you know, can anyone find out information online anywhere about this?
If you need any more advice, you can call 01572 758 301, or you can look at the rutland.gov.uk website and seek further information.
Rutland Radio.
It's Rutland Radio. Hundreds of years ago in Collie Weston, there was a palace. Would you believe that? There was a palace in Collie Weston. At the moment, I'm here on an archaeological survey just to try and find out how much of it remains. And it's just at the corner of Back Lane and New Road. We see a sundial in front of us. I'm here with Paul and Sandra from Collie Weston, Paul and Sandra Johnson. And, well, what do you know about it so far?
We know that there was originally a manor house built in the early 1400s, which was knocked down, rebuilt, and eventually came into the ownership of Lady Margaret Beaufort, who was the mother of Henry VII. She extended it and embellished it, built on an extra courtyard, so we think it's possibly a three-courtyard building, and it is sitting somewhere at the bottom of High Street running along the Welland Valley. We've done lots of research through St John's College in Cambridge and Northamptonshire Archives and come across lots of documents that tell you little snippets about it. Henry VIII's daughter had a big wedding party here which lasted for about 3 weeks, and then set off to marry James IV of Scotland back in 1503. Margaret Beaufort died in 1509, and then the house became the property of Henry VIII. Don't think she'd been too pleased with her grandson, with what he got up to, but there you go. And then eventually it started to decay. By 1540, it was virtually gone. We think we can see various little bits of it in other buildings within the village. It was obviously used as a source of materials, but the rest of it we don't know. So we're just trying to find a wall or something that will give us some idea of just how big it was, because we think it was quite large, and where it actually sat in the landscape. It was a very important building. She administered the East Midlands from here, well, the Midlands from here, actually, and entertained lots of people. It was her favourite residence. Fantastic views. Can't think of a better place to put one, really.
It is fantastic, absolutely, as you look at to the Welland Valley. So by palace, you are talking about a ruler who ruled the region from Collie Weston.
Yes, she did, on behalf of her son. So, yeah, and he spent time here. Apparently it was one of his favourite places as well. So, yeah, it was a royal palace. It was. There's a record in one of the historical documents that says it was fit and neat for a king, which was Henry VIII.
And, well, you can't get much more notorious than Henry VIII, can you? But just looking at the site now, this is, you know, it's got trees planted, the ground isn't all that level. From what you understand, there's been two buildings on where we're standing now.
Yes, there was. It was There was an original manor house, then there was the manor that Margaret Beaufort had. There was another manor house on here which would belong to the Tryon family from Haringworth. And there are records that they found evidence of Margaret Beaufort's palace in their stackyard. We're not quite sure where the stackyard is, unfortunately. So there are actually three different buildings on here. We're looking for the one that was bequeathed to Margaret Beaufort in 1487 in the Great Grant from her son. But we may well come across evidence of the others as well. Some of it obviously is now private land, and some of it has been built on again in the 1800s, so it's quite a challenge. But hopefully we'll find something. We've had three different archaeologists come out and have a look at the site, and they have said, we will find something. What we'll find, we don't know, but we will find something. So it gives us hope.
And this is really, I suppose, for village records, to find out what was here, to kind of fill in the gap of, what, 600 years ago?
Yeah, definitely. We want to record it, share it. We've got to report back to Historic England because it's a scheduled monument, so we have to tell them anyway. And what we do will only be a small part of possibly what might be done in the future. So it's preserving the history of the village and showing people how important this little village was, because we're not very big now. But at one time, this palace had up to 400 people living in it. So it was quite significant, and it's just such a shame that there is nothing left.
Highlights from the past 7 days, the Rutland Radio Podcast.
Grow Together is a new community project which has been backed by Rutland County Council, and it's run with the help of local volunteers. The aim is to get people together, experienced and inexperienced gardeners, to launch their own little community gardening projects within their area. And Saturday's the launch for that, so that the people who sort of turn up on Saturday, whatever their interests are, Claire and Alex with the Growing Together project will enable people to get together, form groups and come up with ideas for their community. So that might be a community vegetable patch, it might be a community herb garden, it might be just a lot of beautiful flowers that will be fantastic for the insects and so the environment around us. So, I mean, it really is that sort of flexible in terms of enabling people to bring what they like to the party, if you like.
And it's at the castle, Oakham Castle, this coming Saturday?
Yes, it is, from 10 until 1 o'clock, and there are going to be lots of activities. Obviously, you can meet Claire and Alex themselves. I think there are all sorts of activities, sort of vegetable printing for the children. There's going to be an artist there helping do still life drawing, all sorts of things.
Rutland Radio.
Hello, I'm Alex Wilby, and I'm one of the founders of Root and Branch Out, who are delivering this Grow Together project for Active Rutland.
Now, it's Oakham Castle, the launch this weekend, Saturday, tomorrow as it will be. So who are you aiming this at? Just anyone with, you know, who wants to garden, I suppose?
Pretty much, yeah. If you've got an idea or you'd like to know more about gardening, or you're an experienced gardener but would like to share your skills with someone else, or have an idea for a community project within your village or town or area, then we can help you to do that. That's what this project is aimed at. So it's getting people outside, doing some gardening, whether it's vegetable growing or flower growing or making something amazing or composting or whatever, we're here to help.
And the plant pots, people are going to make them out of newspaper?
Yes, so we've salvaged some newspapers. We put something out on FreeCycle and people have given us some newspapers that they read that would then go into recycling bins. You then wrap those round a tin can and you tuck it all in, and then you can put some compost in that and grow whatever you feel like. And then you put that straight in the ground when they're big enough to go out and the weather's warm enough, and then the paper just rots down.
And what's been the response so far? Because, you know, I can imagine gardening clubs and all sorts of people wanting to come along and help.
Yep, some of the local gardening clubs have said they're going to come along. We've had various people say they're going to bring bags of seeds along, which is great. We've got quite a few seeds we've been donated by some of the local garden centres, and also my own seed packets and ones that I've saved from my garden. So yes, please come along with any seeds if you've got them, and we'll swap them around, see if we can grow some really interesting stuff.
So what's the plan after the launch of it on Saturday? Are you going to meet regularly? Are you just going to keep in touch remotely?
Yeah, the idea is we've got some little application forms for people to fill in if they've got an interest to join the project. Then we'll get everyone together in a mutually convenient date in the next sort of 4 to 6 weeks, and then we'll plan what we're going to do. So, you know, our rough idea is we'll do some training sessions, we'll get people's ideas, and then we'll go from there with where it happens, and we'll change locations depending on where people are.
And you've got the support of the council and Active Rutland promoting, obviously, you know, healthy activities outside, but I suppose also that means that there's more of an emphasis, or there's as much of an emphasis on community spaces as people's own gardens.
Yes, it would be really nice to do something as a community garden. We have a community allotment that we're just working on that's in Oakham, which we can use for if anyone would like to have some space on that, they're more than welcome. But also there are other public spaces that we might be able to do a little public bed, whether it's sort of herbs for people to have or vegetables or just something that looks amazing that would help maybe the in bloom committees maybe or something like that. That would be great.
So it could be the start of something really big, actually, for our outdoor spaces where actually you could plant stuff anywhere.
Anywhere, yes, as long as we've got permission to use it and the landowners are happy. Yes, we could grow anything anywhere.
And you're looking for people of all ages, all experiences,
absolutely,
all backgrounds to come along and just support you on Saturday.
Yes, that would be great. The more people, the merrier. We've got a few other activities going on as well as the plants pots. We're going to do some still life drawing of plants and vegetables. So we've got an artist coming along to help us with that. And we've got all the seed swapping as well. And then you can find out about the project that's going to run for the next year.
The weekly Rutland Radio Podcast.
Morning, Rob.
Yes, morning, Trish. How are you this morning?
I'm good. This is really kind of you.
Yeah, no problem at all.
You deserve it, I
thank
thought.
You very much for the nomination. So, first of all, if you could explain the two big events that you're getting ready for and, you know, the group's getting ready for.
Yes, at the moment, for Rutland are really concentrating on their two biggest fundraising events of the year, which will be the men's sale, the weekend of February the 22nd and the 23rd. And then the following week, they move to Barnsdale Lodge Hotel, where it's the Good as New clothes sale on Friday the 1st of March and Saturday the 2nd of March in the morning.
And this is an all-year-round job, and you have a load of people who actually help with this, a load of volunteers who give their time for free.
Yes, the Good as New doesn't actually just happen for that week in the year. It does go on all year round. We collect clothes all year round. But really, from the middle of January, this is where our 60 volunteers really dedicate their time and really their energy to supporting this sale. And their range of skills is quite remarkable.
And I hear you've actually got 19 new volunteers, new people helping you this year.
Yes, it's really exciting, Rob. Of course, we always need volunteers, and new volunteers especially, and of course, bringing new skills. I mean, we have people that particularly like ironing, steaming, sewing. Some of them prefer looking after everybody and providing tea and coffee. But the important thing is that they're giving their time and their energy to raising funds for Rutland, which, of course, we are desperate to keep those two specialist advisors at Citizens Advice in their jobs.
So what would you like to say to everyone who helps you put on these two amazing events and actually raises money for Rutland?
We'd like to thank them so much for all their hard work and their dedication and their humour in particular to making sure that the Good and New clothes sale is a real success every year, and for bringing all the skills forward that we really need to make this sale come together and create the funds that we need. Our amazing team, and none of them really, Rob, is the individual one. It's the whole team coming together that all knits well together that makes it a very, very special team.
Well, we're delighted to make the four Rutland volunteers our heroes of the week, and we look forward to your two big events over the next few weeks.
Rob, thank you very, very much on their behalf. I will, hopefully they're all listening, but we're very, very grateful for that. Thank you so much.
Well, that's it for this week's Rutland Radio podcast. If you have any comments, you can email us via the website rutlandradio.co.uk, and we'll have a new version on our website from Monday.
This is a download from Rutland Radio. For more information, go to rutlandradio.co.uk.